Today's speakers will be Diane Coleman, Latrain, and Greg Spencer. Greg Spencer joins us from Train. He is a strategic cooperative program leader, and I would like to pass it over to him to get us started today.
Thank you, Andrea. Appreciate the appreciate that, and I thank everyone for spending some time with us this afternoon to talk about something near to dear to everyone's hearts, and that's energy. We're fortunate today to have Diane Coleman speaking. Diane comes to the meeting with over 25 years experience as a strategic energy advisor. And in that role, she's worked with Fortune 500 companies, she's worked with municipalities, she's worked with school districts, so she's well qualified to talk about the things today. So I'm glad that she's part of that. I also want to remind everyone that this is the first part of a series that we'll be presenting concerning energy and energy solutions. That is all part of our new energy performance contract that's available to you, and this is the first part of that. As Andrea talked about, there may be some questions that you have. Those questions can be, you know, typed into the Q&A, or at the end we'll leave time to ask those. So again, I appreciate that. So let's talk about that. Empowering your building. You know, when you think about that today, if you could ask your building to talk to you and say, you know, how are we doing, this might be what it would look like. In fact, this is a visualization. So today, and now more than ever, we've got the ability to see data in ways never before possible. And when we look at these two screenshots, this is really a depiction of a building's energy use over a long period of time, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for an entire year or multiple years. And in that, we can make some very interesting observations about what's going on with that. Are things running right and as we anticipated, or conversely, are things running wrong and inadvertently doing that? So the building on the left, the drawing on the left looks pretty good. The one on the right probably needs some opportunities to do something different. So there's a lot of analytics that are available today. And something we're going to be talking through. You know, when we look at things as a company, Train, we really look at things from a partnering effect. You know, what are the things that are important to you from a business perspective or from facilities? How do we help you navigate those strategies, whether it's a purchasing strategy, whether it's an energy sourcing, whether it's a storage issue, a consumption? There's a lot of things that need to be looked at and evaluated on these discussions. And we come with that to the table with that with a lot of experience, 100 plus years of experience. So we think we're pretty well suited to have that discussion to help through a comprehensive strategy and discussion with that. So that's what we're going to be talking through today. You know, part of the things today are controlling energy, and Diane's going to be touching on some of these things. But one of the things we don't always realize is we actually can do things. We can actually control things. Part of that might be an energy reduction. And if we think statistically, if we could just reduce the energy spend by 10%, in what impact would that have on your budget? That could be pretty significant dollars depending on your facility size. But regardless, it could be 10%. It could be more than that. I think just knowing that you do control that is an important strategy. There's a lot of things that come into that. You know, maybe some design. It could be an age issue that will impact operational costs. It could be where you're getting energy from. It could be how it's being used. It also could be how we're investing our capital or using our capital. Is that a bonded number? Is it a budget expense? How do we deal with that? It could be more of a greenhouse effect or a green issue. You know, do we want to be more sustainable? What does that look like? How do we reduce our footprint? So I want to pass it over to Diane and have her walk us through some of the strategies she wants to talk through and think are very important. Diane?
Thanks, Craig. I think I'm advancing. Yep. All right, now I am. Took a minute. Okay. Thank you. Sorry for the delay. Appreciate you all taking the time. And I have been in this industry a long time on the supply side. If I use any terminology, you know, please stop me on that or put a question in the chat box and we can further explain it. When businesses are really looking at reducing their energy costs, they tend to focus solely on improving efficiency, eliminating waste, two very worthy approaches, of course. According to a recent Deloitte study, 80% of the business respondents view reducing electricity consumption as essential to staying competitive. Yet, many of our clients overlook the very basics of their energy invoice, the price they pay for the energy. Supplier and utility rates determine the energy spend, but many folks don't know what those are, what they're paying, or what they could do about it. With some projected energy cost volatility in all of our futures, how will you deal with these increasing financial risks? Our customers want to buy it smart, manage it smart, and use it smart. Train is representing a comprehensive solution, looking both at both sides of the meter, really, for procurement, risk management, a number of energy demand services that are listed as OPEX or CAPEX here. What brings the two together in the middle, you'll see, is data management. It's turning data into information for really decision support. Think of a quick analogy on supply and demand as taking your building to a gas station, filling it up as you would fill up your car. Demand management helps the building owner get the best fuel economy for the building, and supply management helps the building owner get the best price at the pump. So I'll ask you to think about your building, as Greg did, in terms of a comprehensive solution driven by your energy management strategy. Visualize your energy bill. That could be from a supplier, from your utility, or a combination of that. Can't see it? You don't want to see it? Well, you're not alone. Many business owners really just pay the bill, gets put in a file, whether that's a paper file or on a worksheet somewhere, and many feel like they don't have control over it. We're going to talk about regulated and deregulated markets, but in both cases, companies are faced with choice and flexibility when it comes to how they can purchase their energy. They want to be able to answer three questions when management starts looking into costs. Did I get the right price for my supply? How do I prove it? And does my energy supply strategy align with my business needs? Supply management is not only a procurement or supply chain concern. Their facilities folks, accounting, finance managers find that better decision support using information on their energy spend drives them further towards their business goal. It's not just worksheets of data, but information on what the data says about your energy spend. Let's review some basic energy price components here on slide 7. Energy is the market or the commodity price per kilowatt hour and can include the cost of renewable generation sourcing, which we see more of today. Generation could also include components like congestion, load following costs, and ancillary services that are really required to generate the load real time. Demand charges here are really known as capacity or network transmission charges. They're measured by the utility and by the grid operator, sometimes referred to as an ISO, independent system operator. Well, they're impacted by the consumers in a way that is by kilowatt demand. And we're going to talk about the difference in kilowatt and kilowatt hour shortly. Capacity is a requirement of those grid operators in several electricity markets. So I have it as a separate component here. These charges help guarantee that there will be sufficient generation to meet the maximum energy requirements of the market at all times. Transmission, another demand charge, is associated with the cost. Think about moving the power from the generator to your local distribution company, which is also known as your utility. And it can be billed as a transmission charge from your supplier or from your local utility, depending on your state and the type of supply pricing that you have. The supplier pricing structures and visibility into demand or time of use are also going to impact your electricity costs because the risk premiums and margins from suppliers depend on forecasting how and when the power is being consumed. It's really important when you compare the total price of your electricity across suppliers to also consider some of the added monthly charges we see customers incur. It's all of these elements of a supply charge which help us compare retail suppliers. By understanding these pricing components here, and we'll talk more about the impact as we go, but it's really about calculating your overall price for electricity so you're better prepared to ask questions about what is and what is not included in your pricing, and therefore you are in a better position to make decisions about which product, offering, and supplier will work best for your business. An energy advisor can help bring these components together while also giving a transparent competitive analysis to really optimize your supply options. There are over 3,000 utilities in all the United States, and they all have their own rates and tariffs for the distribution of your electricity. So when was the last time that your organization assessed whether or not your accounts were actually on the optimum utility rates? To add to this complexity, there are hundreds of electricity and natural gas suppliers nationwide. Again, an independent energy advisor can help you kind of cut through the chaos and make fair and accurate comparisons. The utility providers and the building owners are really facing new challenges as energy supply undergoes a transformation with more renewable generation, less nuclear, coal, and oil, and rising natural gas costs due to some exports over time. This map that you see indicates the natural gas and electricity markets and where you have a choice. So when I say you have a choice, I speak of a deregulated market, and that's in the green here. Deregulated states are the regions of the highest impact, but Trane actually manages $14 billion of energy spend across the entire realm of North America with natural gas and electricity strategies for regulated and deregulated markets in every region. So we compare many times the utility, what I'm going to call like your default supply, if you do not have a choice. We compare that to all available supply options. And even in a few of these states that you see in green that are deregulated, where you have a choice, it may be better to remain on the utility instead of choosing a third-party supplier. To help you understand your utility bill components, it's really good to understand the simple definition of a kilowatt and a kilowatt hour. Many of you may know that the kilowatt hour is how your utility bills appear with a measure of how much energy you're using over time. It's a unit of measure that really equals the amount of energy you were using if you kept 1,000 watts, so a kilowatt, running for an hour. That kilowatt is also known as demand, and by demand, I really mean what demand your load is placing on the overall electric operating system at any given moment. Think of your building as a car again. Really, the speed at which you're going is going to set your kilowatts, your demand. In deregulated states, this can be set once at your highest speed, and you will be charged those demand costs over the entire year based on that rate. So it's always good to mind your speed, right? So how many miles you travel is then going to be your total usage or your kilowatt hours. So let's look at demand, or what I call peak usage. It comes from capacity and transmission components on your electricity invoice. You pay more during the peaks when everyone else is using the highway or the electricity grid. And it's that peak, your highest speed, that has the most impact on your total cost. So think about that in terms of this visual. And a question we often hear from customers is, well, how is that kilowatt demand measured in price? So you can clearly see it here in terms of traffic, but to assess a customer's peak load or demand, their peak usage is really compared to the peak demand on the entire electricity grid. It's often referred to as a coincident peak. They differ by region, and they occur most often during extreme weather conditions. So there are utility demand charges, which reset every month, and grid operator demand charges, which stay the same all year round based on a consumer's annual peak. And again, depending a lot on your region and how you're charged. Page 11 depicts the energy savings found on a typical electricity invoice. Starting from the left, we look at whether or not a customer's bill has been rendered correctly. Utilities and third-party suppliers have been known to make errors. Then you look at utility tariff optimization, which means that in regulated markets, the utility distribution rates really can still be optimized, which rate you're on. And that goes for regulated or deregulated markets. But also in a deregulated market, a consumer can negotiate for supply and optimize for their peak demand and volume. So here we look at a peak load management service to help reduce the overall cost on an energy invoice. Supplier negotiation is a big element of your savings. Many of the products that we see from suppliers are similar in name, but they can actually vary dramatically based on contract terms, the components included, any pricing structure, and service level. So you look at the difference between each offering, and it really adds up. You also look at the energy efficiency on the far right, and all of these together, you're looking at on-peak or off-peak usage and where it has the biggest impact on your electricity invoice. Train provides a no-cost review. We call it an opportunity assessment. Think of it as an energy invoice and supply audit. In order to receive this opportunity assessment, a client will provide 12 months of utility invoices, any current energy supply contracts they may have for natural gas or electricity. And what we do is we review any negotiated utility contract for compliance to industry standards. We might review their supply contract if they have one for commercially reasonable terms. We review the invoices for overall accuracy, and that can even include things like power factor, tax exemption. And we conduct a historic rate comparison, really, for the available invoice period. We identify availability of alternative supply options, and that might be things like I've mentioned where you have a utility tariff rate, and there might be a better one to be part of, or there is your utility supply versus your third-party or deregulated supply. An opportunity assessment, and this is an example of one that we did for a university in New York, it can really tell folks about their invoices and even more than they realize. This is an example on the next page of really some of the dollars we found by examining their utility invoices. The first one was a big one, and this is in New York, so it is a deregulated area. And in regards to their electricity procurement across multiple facilities, we found savings up to $100,000 per year. It really was a benchmark between what we see the electricity prices for our current clients and what they were paying. Some of that is market timing, and some of it is just good supplier comparison. As you saw, there's savings there. The other opportunity in the case of this assessment for this university was in demand charge reduction. So if they could carve out 100 kW, it would yield $9,500 annually. We also found in this opportunity assessment a chance to apply utility bill management. Utility bill management is really an industry term for a data platform that houses all your utility bills, and it allows multiple sites to really access the information to help them support decisions. It allows both the energy management team, accounting teams to review cost and usage information interactively, and reports are customized and they can compare year-over-year performance, they can compare ENERGY STAR scores. There's a number of pieces of information that utility bill management platforms can provide. And that's what we do in an opportunity assessment. I'll take any questions at the end, and now Greg has some further insight for you.
Well, thank you, Diane. Powerful information. Just to add on to what she was talking about, we also, if you live in deregulated markets for your homes, you probably have that same ability to make those decisions, i.e., which power plant is best for your home usage. And there's ways to gather the data on your meter and marry that up with the best utility plan that's available to you. So It's all about awareness and taking action with that. So as we started with today, there's a lot of power in the data. And, you know, having a visualization is important. It makes it easy. I'm an engineer and a spreadsheet kind of guy, so I certainly like that. But I also like the fact that if I can see it easier and make decisions, I'll do that. And seeing this data in a graphical form is a great way to start. So we want to go gather that data, whether it's using this analytics or whatever you've got, and put it together. You want to then sit down and review that with an advisor, someone that's aware of your local statutes on procurement, on the local tariffs that are being applied to that from your utilities, whether it's the right rate, what the demand charges are, how they calculate the demand charges. They're not always easy to see. Some of those are KW demand, so many KWH for every KW demand, for example. So it's difficult to ascertain really what you're using and how it's being billed out to you. So there's a review to be had. And then finally, more importantly, to sit down and develop a strategy. How do we manage that? What does it look like? Do we measure it? Because once we start measuring it, then we can start taking, you know, concerted action. All right, so that's part of this key. My screen's not moving, sorry about that. We need to understand. We always want to start by just understanding what's really important to us. How do we manage that? Whether we start at the meter, whether we start at the procurement source, and really taking it back to, you know, accounting 101, which is every asset, your building, utilities, every asset has a value and needs to be available to meet whatever commitments you need it to be. So we want to continue to sit there and find ways to identify some actionable items. We need to find ways to reduce energy consumption and operating costs, how to go track those goals against whatever metrics you set up, and then be proactive moving forward. And that's what this whole concept of energy performance contracting is about, or energy services. And if you haven't already, let's review just a little bit. You know, how do we even start? You know, it doesn't have to be a gargantuan effort that someone comes in and inundate you with staff and things like that. It can be as simple as sit down, look at our facility, and establish some type of baseline. You know, whether that's a baseline in a single facility, whether it's a baseline for an entire campus, whatever baseline would make sense. Once you've established a baseline, we use a number of analytics for that, whether that's development software. In the case of Train, we use Trace. There are a lot of them out there that E2C or Energy Star or Blast or Doe. There's a lot of different tools out there that are available to you to do baseline programming. And then once you have a baseline, you can sit down then and start establishing some type of strategy. What do we need to change? What would be the cause effect? If I did this, then what would happen? And then ultimately making a change. We got to go implement. You got to go do something. And then ultimately coming back there and validating the things that we did that we thought were going to change, did they actually change? And to what degree? And those are all important for them. And then finally, going out there and promoting and educating within your facilities everything that's being done. And whether that's a dashboard that keeps that in front of people so that you see this is how much energy we're using today, right now, or these are the things that are important for us. There may be some things, you know, that aren't so constricted about, you know, the energy itself. It may be we want to be more sustainable. We want to have a greener footprint. Maybe we want to look at being, you know, what we're doing to the greenhouse. There could be also things in there that aren't necessarily attributable directly to a utility bill. It may be, you know, what are future energy or equipment replacement needs? What are the operating costs for that? You know, what have been our service costs, our maintenance costs? You know, what are the financial options as we look forward that we should employ to achieve those things? Do I need guaranteed results, for example, to make that investment? So there's a lot of stuff out there today that we'll be talking about, just like today, to help you improve your facility's operating and financial performance. So I thank you for your time today. We've gone through this a little bit faster than we anticipated. We want to open the lines up now for any questions and answers you might have. Diane and I will both be available to talk through those or answer the questions, and if not, we'll certainly get you an answer. So, Andrea, do you want to open the lines up?
Yes. Thanks so much for presenting, Diane and Greg. If you have any questions, please go ahead and feel free to type them into the chat panel or the Q&A session, and we will go ahead and get started with the Q&A session here. And Greg and Diane, we did have a couple of questions to come through here, so we can go ahead and get started.
All right.
All right. Can meter consolidation help, or is it better to keep meters separate? Greg, you want to take that one?
I'll take that one. That's a great question. We get that a lot. Depending on your utilities, because it's really dependent on the supply side, aggregation of meters can sometimes save you money, because having a single aggregation point puts you at a different point on your price tiering. So when we go back and do this evaluation, we certainly look at the benefits of meter consolidation, or if in your particular area that would have no effect, we want to know that as well. So the answer is it depends, and many times it does. So good question.
Excellent. All right, we did have another question to come in. Is there still an opportunity for me to save if I'm in a regulated market?
And I can take that. The answer is yes. We certainly have plenty of customers in a regulated region, and where we want them to focus is on their actual utility rate review. So it would be looking at what you're paying on the utility, and if, for example, you were able to change any portion of your demand when you use it, sometimes that will impact your utility rate. It might just be that you made changes to the building, you were on one utility rate, and it might be more advantageous to be on another. So we'll look at your utility rates, we'll look at any other charges that may appear on those utility bills, even though you don't have a separate supplier choice. And the other portion of that opportunity assessment I briefly mentioned was, if you do have multiple sites, we like to be able to offer an option on utility bill management. Folks would be able to take advantage of that in any region of the country.
Thanks, Diane. All right. Another question here. This is kind of a double-part question. Rate conformance, are we paying what we're supposed to? In many areas with a ratchet rate schedule, it's difficult to know what or why you're paying.
So I can manage that as well. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. I briefly touched on a question that our customers frequently have, which is, how do I know if I'm paying demand charges? And I often hear them say, well, I have a really good fixed rate. But until you peel that back and understand the components of what's in that rate, let's say you provide there's some energy efficiency measures taken, and you have lowered some of your demand. Those components of your pricing are what I'm going to call the rate conformance, if this answers it, is you're not seeing the benefits of that reduction in usage and demand because you have a fixed rate. Again, you would look at it from a regulated side and what your utility rates are, and you might also look at it from a supplier side and what type of supply rates you have when you want to understand what rates you're paying. Hopefully that answered it.
Okay, great. Another question here. In my area, it's pretty much PSEG. That's the only supplier of electricity. How do you deal with a local monopoly in terms of negotiation?
So I'll touch on that. I am familiar with PSE&G, and it didn't say electricity or natural gas, but I'll assume that it's electricity. And there are choices. That is an area that we serve and provide multiple supply options. So maybe we'll follow up with the person who asked the question and find out exactly where they're located within PSE&G. There are different regions and zones, so we may want to just make sure they have all the choices, but that is the type of work that we do, is just making sure you even know what supply options are out there. But if that is underneath PSE&G in what we call the PJM, electricity grid area, you would have a choice of suppliers.
Okay, great. And that's in Long Island, and we can follow up after. All the presenters will have the questions after. Okay, great.
Yeah, I am aware of some Long Island constraints, so we will definitely answer that one.
Excellent. All right, and then another question here. I heard there are recent incentives in Illinois specific to solar. Do you see additional renewable rebates in the future?
So Greg mentioned you want to touch on what you have there, and then
We anticipate we see renewable energies as continue to be up and coming in many areas, and I would suspect it'll be there as well. We've seen investments in that technology, continued investment obviously, but they've been hamstrung by some issues lately. So we continue to see those rebates being offered. I think it's a good way for sustainable energy, the same as we see wind energy in some states. So we want to continue to evaluate those. And in many ways, when we do contracting jobs or energy performance jobs, they can be employed in there and those rates taken into account and those discounts. So, we always want to evaluate those on a case-by-case basis, but in many ways it'll make sense.
And I'll also add to that, there are things changing in Illinois, and while this is my business every single day, I'm not always the expert in every state. Energy Supply Services has about 40, 50 people who represent our expert staff, so we will want to follow up on that one as well in terms of the where you're located within Illinois and what some of the specifics are, because there are some changes and more incentives in Illinois.
Excellent. All right, another question here. Can you provide trend review analysis? Greg, you want to take that one?
Yeah, I'll take that. The answer is yes, we do. We think that's an important strategy to employ, right off the bat at a high level, and then we're certainly drilling down into getting the weeds, if you will. The trend analysis isn't only just for consumption or another factors in there. There may be others. We want to compare that trend analysis against known metrics, i.e. Energy uses per square foot, like BT per square foot from that perspective, based on the facility type. We may also look at a dollar per square foot. So yes, the answer is we do that, and we certainly look forward to helping you with those.
Excellent. All right. Are there metrics to compare use against BTU square footage or dollar per square footage?
Yeah. Just as I was saying, there are established guidelines across all areas, and really based on the facility type. We have if you're in the school area, whether it's an auditorium, whether it's a lunch area or an eating area or a classroom. We know pretty much what we think the energy per square foot based on density or dollar per square foot ought to be in a facility overall. So absolutely we want to present those and compare those, and much like anything, once you start benchmarking your facility against known metrics, you kind of have a better feel, or are you within the boundaries, or if you're way out of bounds, what's causing that and what can be done about that. That's really where we want to go with it. Good question.
Great. And one more question also came through. Are there any best practices for annual energy needs planning?
So I'll start there. Greg, chime in if there's something else. You're talking best practices. Was it energy need?
For annual energy needs planning.
Yes. So I think what you heard today, in certainly in taking the components of your electricity bill, can also look at your natural gas demand, which we didn't spend a lot of time on today. But when it comes to best practices, understanding what's on your invoice and tracking that information and trending it over time Most people feel that the energy markets have been lower priced, but what they don't realize is that components of the pricing that we talked about today, like capacity and transmission, have actually gone up about 10% per year in some regions. And again, there are some region specifics when it comes to best practices. Monitoring your utility rates, and if you haven't looked at it, we do this about once a year for our clients, is to make sure changes within a building have not impacted your utility rates. So that would be another important area. And, you know, overall, it is, again, not just about the supply side. And when I look at, you know, buying it smart, managing it smart by knowing what's on all your utility invoices. But in the end, it's about using it smart and knowing the value of when it makes sense to lower your demand and what that would mean to you in your particular facility. So for me, those would really be the best practices. Hopefully we've answered that for you.
Okay, great. Greg, did you have anything to add, or?
I don't. I was going to say bingo.
Good. All right. There are currently no more questions that have come through. For Greg and Diane, is there anything additional you would like to add?
One is, be on the lookout. We appreciate your time today. We've got cooperative contracts with U.S. communities for energy services, or performance contracting, if you will. We also have a HVAC equipment and services that allows you to procure and use the contract with that as well. So it's pretty broad-based. Our next, as I talked about, this series of webinars will really be focused on improving your performance of your facilities, and be on the lookout for the next one that's coming out. You know, we'll let you know when that is.
And I just have a couple of comments. We had a limited amount of time today. We encourage, if you know somebody within your team who wasn't able to make it to the webinar, it is being recorded, and that'll be available. And also available to you will be an opportunity to take advantage of that energy invoice audit, speaking with your train representative to see if we can dig deeper and uncover some savings in your energy invoices. So appreciate it.